வணக்கம். When there is a nerve injury or nerve involvement, we all know that generally we have to do a motor, sensory and autonomic testing of the nerve function. But there are certain systematic procedures that need to be done in the right way to get a correct evaluation of the nerve function, and we also need to understand the basis of the test and the different procedures that are done. After performing the tests as prescribed, we also need to interpret the results and correlate clinically. This video deals with exactly that, the clinical assessment of nerve injury or damage. When there is any clinical problem, we need to first assess the problem. Without assessment, we cannot treat, we cannot communicate, and we cannot progress. This very much holds good in involvement of the peripheral nervous system. It could be trauma with global injuries like brachial plexus injuries, where along with the lower motor neuron lesion, there may also be an associated upper motor neuron lesion. Peripheral nerve injuries can also occur from localized injuries like this acute injury, where there is an obvious ulnar claw, or this patient presenting with a radial nerve palsy of the right upper limb following an assault injury on the right arm. Infective etiology like Hansen's disease can also cause peripheral nerve system disorders, as also tumors involving the nerves and compressing the nerves, as in the example of this patient with an obvious tumor in the medial side of the upper arm, resulting in a high median nerve palsy. Conditions like entrapment neuropathy, as in this example of carpal tunnel syndrome, can also cause disorders of the peripheral nervous system. So when we decide to do a clinical assessment of a peripheral nerve problem, we have got four headings under which we do the assessment. The first is an analysis of the complaints, the history, the general examination, and the neurological examination. The commonest complaints in a peripheral nerve disorder, apart from weakness of the muscles, are pain, tingling, loss of sensation, and numbness. In some situations, these symptoms are enough to come to a probable diagnosis, as in the case of carpal tunnel syndrome, by using the CADS and STERAT hand diagram, where the patient is asked to specifically chart out the areas on the hand where numbness, pain, tingling and diminished sensation are present. By analyzing this data, an appearance like this with involvement of two of the first three fingers, that is the thumb, index and midfinger, will give a classic pattern pointing towards the diagnosis of carpal tunnel syndrome. And if the symptoms involve predominantly a single finger of the lateral three fingers, it would point to a probable diagnosis of carpal tunnel syndrome. If it does not involve the lateral three fingers at all, but only the ulnar side, most probably it is not a carpal tunnel syndrome. Next, the detailed history must be elicited. The hand dominance of the patient, occupation, and the previous injury, if any, should be recorded. The mechanism of injury, if it has been a trauma, should be recorded. The onset of symptoms, whether insidious or sudden, aggravating and relieving factors, functional limitations as a result of the problem should also be analyzed in detail. We also need to look for any diagnostic test or imaging that has been performed and the results that have been obtained. After getting a thorough history, we need to do a general examination, look for scars of injury or previous surgery, trophic ulcers and healed ulcers on the fingers or feet are telltale signs of a peripheral nerve problem. After this, we need to do a thorough neurological examination. A detailed neurological examination will consist of six steps. Assessment of the mental status, whether the patient is conscious, oriented with respect to space and time, the cranial nerves involvement, assessment of the motor system, assessment of the sensory system, the coordination and gait analysis and reflex testing need to be done. However, since we are concentrating on the peripheral nerve problems, we shall be dealing mainly with the motor system assessment and the sensory system assessment in this video. But at this point, we need to understand what is the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. The signals beginning in the brain travel down the brainstem to the spinal cord, and this constitutes a central nervous system consisting of the upper motor neurons. When there is a lesion of this part of the nervous system, it is called the upper motor neuron lesion. When this happens, the control of the lower motor neuron systems is lost because the brain no longer is able to control the lower motor neurons, and they go into what is known as an excited state. This is because the inhibition that has been exercised by the upper motor neurons is lost. This is manifest by rigidity or spasticity of the paralyzed muscles and exaggerated tendon reflexes. Once the nerve impulses reach the spinal cord, they travel via the peripheral nerves to the end organs like the muscles to bring about action. Lesion at this level of the nervous system is called the lower motor neuron lesion. In this lesion, the function of the lower motor neurons is lost, and hence there is an inhibitory state of the peripheral nerves manifest by flaccidity of the paralyzed muscles. We shall begin the assessment of the peripheral nervous system by the motor examination. The motor examination here consists of five important parts: assessment of the nutrition, assessment of the tone, the power of the muscles, the coordination tests, and the deep reflexes. The nutritional status of the muscle can be assessed indirectly by assessing the bulk of the muscle mass. This is usually measured with a tape as representative of its activity about 5 inches above the elbow and 4 inches below the elbow for the muscle mass in the arm and the forearm, and 9 inches above the knee and 6 inches below the knee for assessment of the muscle mass in the lower limb. It should be compared to the opposite side if that side is unaffected. The tone of the muscle refers to the tension that is palpable in the muscle. This tone or tension can be present whether the muscle is actively contracting or not. There are two types of tone that need to be assessed in the muscle: the passive tone and the active tone. The passive tone measures the tone in the antagonistic muscles when the agonistic muscle is acting. Normally, the antagonistic muscles should relax and allow the agonists to act. In upper motor neuron lesions, there will be a spasticity or rigidity depending on the lesion, whether it is pyramidal or extrapyramidal respectively. This will not allow the antagonistic muscles to relax. For instance, when we are passively flexing the elbow, the triceps should relax. This will not happen in an upper motor neuron lesion. To demonstrate the example of testing the passive tone of the muscles, the example of elbow flexion is shown here. When the elbow is passively flexed and extended, the examiner's hand should palpate the triceps muscle and not the biceps. In case of upper motor neuron lesions with involvement of the pyramidal tract, there will be an increased tone in the beginning, and once the resistance is overcome, it will become relaxed. This is known as the clasp knife spasticity. In conditions like dementia or Parkinsonism, there will be an increased resistance to the elbow flexion due to the increased tone or rigidity in the triceps muscle, known as lead pipe rigidity. This rigidity will sustain throughout the range of action of the elbow flexion. In conditions of upper motor neuron lesions involving the extrapyramidal system, there will be what is known as the cogwheel rigidity, where there are alternating relaxation and resistance. So far, we have seen the measurement of the passive tone in the muscles. The active tone measures the tone in the muscle or the tension within the muscle when it is acting. Normally, the tone builds up in the acting muscle producing a certain movement. If the muscle is paralyzed, yet the movement is produced by some other synergistic muscle, the loss of tone in the tested muscle will denote paralysis even though the movement appears to be present. To demonstrate the same example that we had shown earlier, that is the elbow flexion, when the active elbow flexion is done, the biceps muscle should be palpated. Similarly, while testing the abduction of the thumb, we need to palpate the abductor pollicis brevis, which will show an increase in the tone of the muscle if the muscle is intact. The next step is testing the power of the muscle. The commonly used grading for the power of the muscle is the MRC scale. This MRC scale for muscle power was first published in 1943 in a document called Aids to the Investigation of Peripheral Nerve Injuries, War Memorandum No. 7. In the 1970s, the document was republished with the title Aids to the Examination of the Peripheral Nervous System, Memorandum No. 45. According to the MRC grading, when there is no contraction in the muscle, it is classified as grade 0. When there is only a flicker or a trace of contraction, it is classified as grade 1. When active movement is possible in the muscle, only with gravity eliminated, it comes under grade 2. And when active movement is possible against gravity, it is grade 3. And when active movement against gravity is possible, and even against minimal resistance, it is classified as grade 4. And grade 5 denotes full range of movements of the muscle against gravity and against maximal resistance, in other words, normal muscle power. But while performing the testing, there are some important points to remember. When we are testing anti-gravity muscles, that is an example like the supraspinatus, where the muscle has to perform the action against gravity, then when the patient is asked to abduct the shoulder, if he is not able to do it, it does not mean it is grade 0. It means it is not grade 3 or more. So, we need to eliminate gravity and then test the muscle whether it is grade 0 or grade 1 or grade 2. In this volunteer, it denotes normal activity of the supraspinatus muscle, that is grade 5. In examples like this, like a brachial plexus injury with involvement of the shoulder abductors, this is not the correct way of testing the supraspinatus muscle. Gravity must be eliminated first, patient must be made to lie down, and then the supraspinatus muscle should be tested. The same testing should be done for all the anti-gravity muscles like the biceps also. If there has been a concomitant head injury, as in the case of multiple trauma involving the upper limb, we can do the coordination tests. The three important coordination tests for the upper limb are the finger-nose test, that is, the patient is asked to take his index finger and touch his nose. This must be done using both upper limbs alternatively. The finger-finger test, where the patient touches the index finger of his left hand with the right hand index finger, and so on. The next test is asking the patient to make circles in the air with the fingers. As far as the lower limb is concerned, the Romberg's test and walking in a straight line are performed. And lastly, the deep tendon reflexes are performed using the knee hammer. The biceps reflex denotes, if it is normal, it indicates healthy innervated muscle. If the reflex is exaggerated, it signifies an upper motor neuron lesion. If totally absent, it signifies a lower motor neuron lesion or loss of muscle. Similarly, the knee jerk is also performed. Now we shall see the methods of sensory testing. Before we go into the different methods of sensory testing, we shall review the basics of the sensory system. The touch sensation is transmitted from the Meissner's corpuscles. The pressure is transmitted by the Merkel discs. Heat is transmitted from the Ruffini plumes, which are present in the skin. The cross end bulbs transmit the cold sensation. Pacinian corpuscles transmit vibration or tickle sensation, and free nerve endings transmit the pain sensation. From these receptors, the sensation travels along the peripheral nerves, reaches the nerve roots, then through the spinal cord, through the brain stem, and across the thalamus to the sensory cortex. There is an important point of difference between pain and temperature and vibration and proprioception sensations following this tract. As far as pain and temperature sensations are concerned, they travel through small unmyelinated fibers and travel in the spinothalamic tract. They cross over in the same level of the spinal cord where they enter. On the other hand, vibration and proprioception sensations travel in large unmyelinated fibers and travel up in the dorsal columns of the spinal cord, but they cross over at the level of the brainstem only. So the main modalities to be tested are tactile sensibility, pain, both superficial and deep, pressure, joint sense, vibration, temperature, and two-point discrimination. The testing of the sensory system is done by three categories of tests. The first are the threshold tests, where the threshold of touch, pressure, pain, temperature, vibration, and joint sense is done. The second category of tests are the functional tests, where two-point discrimination, localization, and the Moberg pickup tests are done. Lastly, the objective tests, that is the Ninhedrin test and the wrinkle test, need to be done. These sensory tests must be done in a quiet room with an ambient temperature. The patient must be comfortably seated. He must close his eyes, or if available, a sensory shield should be used. This picture shows a sensory shield. Patient sits on one side, is not able to see his or her hands, and the sensation can be tested. When the testing is done, the stimulus must directly be applied on the patient's skin. Usually, from the cranial to caudal, the nerves are tested, and it should be done in a symmetrical manner on both sides. First, we must show or demonstrate the test on the normal side and then check on the affected side. To be prepared to do the testing, we need to have certain things ready. It may not be possible always to have the hair esthesiometer or the compass esthesiometer ready, but we can have a certain basic set of equipment to do a comfortable sensory testing. A standard tray containing gloves, a sheet, and cotton wool, from which wisps of cotton can be used for touch sensation, two test tubes for holding cold water and warm water to test temperature, and the knee hammer to test the deep tendon reflexes. The rest of the equipment we shall see as we go along. First, we shall see the assessment of touch sensation. The Von Frey hair test using the camel hair or a horse hair attached to a candle was originally used for testing the sensation. The Sems-Weinstein esthesiometer is the modern equipment used to measure the touch sensation and assess it quantitatively. However, for a qualitative clinical assessment, cotton can be used for assessing the touch sensation. When cotton is used for assessment, we should not drag the cotton over the skin, and the patient should respond when the stimulus is detected. This should be compared with the other side. This testing should be done over the areas represented by the dermatomes, either on the upper limbs or the lower limbs or the trunk. As far as the hands and feet are concerned, there are specific areas where the sensation can be assessed, which represent the autonomous zones of the nerve supplying the hand and foot. When the testing is done with the cotton, the procedure is explained to the patient, and the patient is asked to say yes when he feels the cotton stimulation. It must just be applied on the skin and removed immediately. The commonest areas tested are the thumb, which represents the C6, the index finger, the little finger, and the ulnar side of the palm and the radial side of the palm. When the Sems-Weinstein monofilament is used for testing, the size is chosen and it is kept upon the skin of the patient and gently pressed till the filament folds. According to the patient's perception, the amount of force applied by the monofilament is graded and can be tested. This is color-coded. If the patient is able to feel monofilament 1. It indicates a force of 0.07 and this is normal sensation. If the patient is only able to feel the monofilament number 2, which is blue color, the force is 0.2 and this means reduced tactile sensation. Similarly, as the size of the monofilament increases and the patient is only able to perceive those filaments, it means reduced protective sensation or loss of protective sensation. The pressure sensation or deep touch is measured with what is known as the algometer. Pain measurement is of two types, superficial and deep. While measuring pain, we should not use a hypodermic needle. We can use a pin or an unfolded paper clip. We need to demonstrate first on the unaffected area, then start distally and move proximally. The demonstration of assessment of superficial pain is done here using an opened out paper clip. This sensation is tested as shown in the previous demonstration on touch in the main areas on the thumb, index finger, little finger and palm. The deep pain sensation is elicited by the dull side of the pin. The sharp and dull side of the pin are applied randomly on the skin with a force just to indent the skin. It is applied in each zone at least twice. For temperature testing, test tubes containing water are used. Water at 43 degrees Celsius for hot sensation and water at 10 degrees Celsius, that is iced water, for cold sensation. Proprioception or joint sense is tested by keeping the various joints of the limb in different positions and assessing whether the patient is able to recognize the position. It should be first shown with the eyes open and then tested with the eyes closed. If he cannot detect the position of the joints in the distal joints, it must be done on the proximal joints then. Here the testing of the joint sense is being demonstrated on a healthy volunteer. The joint is kept in a particular position and patient is asked to say whether the finger is now downward or upward. The sense of vibration is called paresthesia. It is mediated by group A beta quickly adapting fibers. Usually, we use a tuning fork with 128 Hz frequency. This is held flat against the patient's finger or hand. We usually hold it at the tip of the finger and ask the patient if he can feel the buzzing. If he is not able to feel it buzzing, we need to go proximally and keep it over the bony prominences so that there is a higher chance of feeling the vibration. The examiner also randomly stops the vibration of the tuning fork and asks the patient to say when he feels the buzzing stop. Now we come to the functional tests that need to be performed. The most important of these is the two-point discrimination. The other tests, like the localization test, where the patient is able to identify what the object is that is being presented, either a pen or a coin, and Moberg pickup test, where the patient is able to pick up the coin or pick up the pen from a set of randomly arranged objects with his eyes closed. Testing the two-point discrimination is of two types. The static test described by Weber, two points are applied simultaneously. We begin with 15 mm and then progressively brought together. 7 out of 10 are taken as the correct response. This two-point discrimination is transmitted by slow adapting fibers. The dynamic two-point discrimination is also important. Here, the caliper is moved longitudinally along the border of the finger from a proximal to distal direction. It starts from 8 mm and goes down to 2 mm. This is transmitted by quickly adapting fibers. It is important to remember here that the dynamic two-point discrimination is the first to return before the static two-point discrimination returns. If the static two-point discrimination is between 1 and 5 mm, it is normal. And if only one point is perceived, it is protective sensation only. If no points are perceived, it is anesthetic. We need to remember that the two-point discrimination is not the same all over the body. It is more over the fingertips. The Mackinnon-Dellen discriminator is a readily available instrument for measuring the two-point discrimination. We can also use a folded paper clip to perform the two-point discrimination testing. After folding the paper clip, the measurement can be made between the two prongs of the folded clip and used to test for two-point discrimination. Testing for autonomic function is appropriate for disorders involving the peripheral nervous system like lepromatous leprosy, diabetic neuropathy, peripheral neuropathy due to other problems, and progressive autonomic neuropathy. According to the American Academy of Neurology, there are four standard techniques for autonomic testing: measuring the heart rate and blood pressure variability during deep breathing, tilt table test, 5 minutes of standing, and the Valsalva maneuver; the thermoregulatory sweat test; the sympathetic skin response; and the quantitative pseudomotor axon reflex test. Sweating is an important function to be tested. Sympathetic denervation following peripheral nerve injury results in immediate loss of sweating, and return of sweating to an area of sensory loss is one of the last cutaneous functions to return during nerve regeneration. Sweating closely parallels the return of two-point discrimination. So that brings us to the objective tests that can be performed: the sweat test and the wrinkle test. The commonly performed sweat test is the ninhydrin test. Here, the hand and fingers are cleansed with soap and warm water for 5 minutes. The patient should not touch any object then. Fingertips are pressed against bond paper and traced with pencil. The paper is then sprayed with ninhydrin reagent with moderate pressure for 15 minutes and allowed to dry for 24 hours. It is heated in an oven 5 to 10 minutes at 200 degrees Fahrenheit. The fingertip with the sweat becomes purple on the paper. Performing the wrinkle test is easier. The hand is placed in warm water, preferably for about 10 to 30 minutes. No wrinkles are seen in the denervated hand. The indications for doing this test are patients in whom the sensory testing cannot be done because it needs a patient response. Children, malingerers, and mentally unstable persons will be eligible for this test. After performing a thorough neurological examination, we can do a numerical grading for the peripheral nerve injury, starting from 0 to 10. This has been done by Lee Dellon and published in the year 1993. Here, 0 represents normal function of the peripheral nerve and grade 10 represents severe muscle atrophy. All these assessment methods are not used only for assessing a peripheral nerve involvement or injury. They are also used during recovery to assess the amount of recovery that is occurring. The usual progression of clinical sensory recovery is from totally anesthetic to protective pinprick sensation, and then moving touch, moving two-point discrimination, and lastly, static two-point discrimination comes to normal. There is also a grading system for this sensory recovery using the MacKinnon-Dellon scale. S0 is absence of sensibility. S1 is recovery of the deep cutaneous pain sensibility. As it keeps improving, it goes up to S3, where there is a return of superficial pain and tactile sensibility, where the static two-point discrimination is more than 15 millimeters and the moving two-point discrimination is more than 7 millimeters. When it goes to S4, there is complete recovery with a static 2PD of 2 to 6 millimeters and a moving 2PD of 2 to 3 millimeters. Even motor recovery can be followed up by good assessment. It starts with a total paralysis, that is grade 0. It slowly increases and it starts from the proximal muscles and extends to the distal muscles as recovery proceeds. This grading scale is useful for documenting the motor recovery. M0 is no contraction of muscle. M3 is M2 plus all muscles can act against resistance. And M4 is where there is M3 grade and synergistic and isolated movements possible in the muscles. M5 is complete recovery. I hope you liked the video. I enjoyed making it. Do click on the following links to see more about the anatomy of the nerve and the function of the nerve. And do not forget to subscribe to keep connected with the latest in learning hand surgery.